It is so hard for me to believe we've reached episode 35 with this podcast. Hi, I'm Daron Vaught. If you're checking us out for the first time ever, welcome into Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. My sincerest thank you for listening for however long you've done so. And you can, of course, check out previous episodes if you'd like. Tell your friends, rate and review. All of that stuff helps the show continue to grow and would be greatly appreciated as well. For this Prospects on Deck edition of the program, we welcome a 2019 Collegiate National Team alum. So I got to know him a little bit that summer after he had played in the College World Series final with his Michigan Wolverines. Since then, Jeff Criswell has had a junior season halted by the coronavirus. He was drafted in the second round by the Oakland Athletics, which is a cool story because that's who also drafted his father, Brian, some years ago, and had an unconventional first season of pro ball. We get into all of those things and more on episode 35 of Covering the Bases. And stick around afterward as I speak with Ben Meyer at Diamond Kinetics to learn how you can take your game to the next level with DK. But Colin, first, let's catch up with our guy, Jeff Criswell. Roll the open, please.
From high above Coleman Field at the USA Baseball National Training Complex in Cary, North Carolina, this is Covering the Bases with Daron Vaught.
I want to start because we've had several guys on here to talk about the abrupt ending to their collegiate seasons. I don't think any that we've had on so far were coming back to a team like your Michigan team that was previously in the College World Series and looking to make another run. So obviously you had those goals in mind. You had the goal of getting drafted in mind, which eventually happened later in the summer. But like, walk me through the day that you found out that your season was done for your junior year. You weren't going to be afforded the opportunity to get back to the College World Series and try to win that with you and your teammates again.
Yeah. So, you know, when I think back to it, now, you know, when word kind of came out about the virus, I believe we were actually coming back from California. We were out there for our spring trip, you know, kind of business as normal. And, you know, when we were on our way back, you know, going through the airport, kind of one of those first couple of days that we got back, you know, we started to hear and get some new information on, you know, kind of what the situation was going to be. And then it was really that next week when we got back into practice. I think it was maybe a Tuesday or a Wednesday. And we have a leadership team at the University of Michigan, you know, for our baseball program. You know, consists of like five guys, and then we had a couple captains as well. So, Coach Backich brought everybody into, his office. You know, he kind of wanted to address us, talk to us about the information that he could get, you know, on what the season was going to look like going forward. And, you know, he let us know, made us aware that we, you know, were unfortunately going to, probably have to cancel the season. And then he proceeded to kind of bring everybody together and, you know, we got the news as a team. So, you know, it was a very, very hard time, I think, for everyone. You know, we had felt good with where we were at. You know, we didn't have the best trip out in California, but things were kind of felt like they were starting to come together a little bit for Team 154 there. And it was definitely an emotional time for everyone. You know, we were kind of blindsided by it in a sense, you know, like I had mentioned there was a little bit of talk, but, you know, we felt a little bit blindsided by everything. And, you know, after that, after we got the news, you know, we kind of went out on the field as a team, And came together for really, you know, one last time as Team 154. So, it was sad. You know, it was an emotional time. I think it was especially emotional for our seniors, guys like Ben Kaiser, who had been in the program for, you know, that was his fifth year. You know, just knowing that we weren't probably going to be able to put the black M on our chest anymore was definitely, you know, something that was hard to swallow, and hard to process. And, you know, we were fortunate because we have 30, you know, 35 or so other guys surrounding us to, you know, be there, and we're all a part of it together. But it was definitely an emotional time for a lot of guys, and especially the upperclassmen group with the juniors and seniors who, you know, just weren't sure what their futures at Michigan were going to look like.
Yeah. And I'm glad you mentioned Kaiser, because he's one of a group that whose situation, is less fortunate than somebody like yours, right? You eventually got picked second overall. Baseball, you knew and had a feeling at that point was going to continue for you personally past your Michigan days, no matter when those ended, right? What do you remember about talking to those guys like Kaiser, who you've known for a long time, right? Like since you guys were teenagers, because you grew up in the same area. What do you remember from their emotions talking about the idea that, you know, obviously before you begin your senior season, if you know baseball is done for you after that year, you've kind of started to come to grips with it. But, you know, you have this timeline in your mind. You're like, okay, I don't have to worry about that until the summer. And then then it's really going to hit. What do you remember from just their emotions? Because everybody was shocked.
Yeah, you know, it was exactly that. It was pure shock. And like you had mentioned, I have a good, really, really good relationship with Ben. He's from Portage as well. I'm from Portage. And, although he's a couple years older than me, we didn't, you know, cross paths too many times in high school. There's always been that connection between us. So our relationship has grown a lot stronger, you know, through our time at Michigan. And, you know, I remember he was we had kind of a core group of, you know, maybe five or six guys who decided to stay in Ann Arbor during quarantine. And I think when we all kind of went into quarantine and everything, my conversations with Ben were just, you know, he's going to get his opportunity. And I think that's what everybody knew. You know, Kaiser's one of those kids who, is just wired a little bit differently, right? You know, he is the hardest worker. You know, he's the guy there the earliest at the field. He's going to stay the latest. He was just kind of a true embodiment of what a Michigan man was. So I think everybody knew that Ben was going to get the opportunity to play at the professional level. And, you know, I don't think anybody knew what that was going to look like at that time. But I think, you know, as teammates, you know, I can't speak for anybody else and I can't speak for the coaching staff, but I think we were all very, very hopeful that Ben was going to get an opportunity to play professional baseball, you know, whatever that would look like. You know, with a shortened draft, that obviously made things difficult. But, you know, Ben was truly deserving of getting that opportunity and fully capable of playing at the professional level. So I think everybody, you know, really, really feels for those type of guys, guys in that situation, you know, when they've given so much and they've given years and years and just countless hours of time to the program, you know, at Michigan. I think everybody felt for those guys when it got cut short. But for guys like Ben and a couple other guys in his position, like I said, you know, I think we knew that they were still going to be able to get opportunities to play professional baseball and, you know, ultimately turn pro blue. Like, you know, some of the juniors got the same opportunity.
So. Yeah. Yeah. And when I mentioned Ben, it wasn't necessarily for the sake of the example that I gave that baseball would be done for him. So you're right. It's been cool to see guys in those situations still get opportunities, even when the summer and this year has been as messy as it has been. What about maybe teammates that were hoping for that extra year of eligibility to come back? Did Michigan have any of those to your knowledge?
We did have one guy, his name's Joe Pace. He's actually coming back now for his sixth year. And, you know, he's another guy right there with that core group with Ben, and Jimmy Kerr, guys who have been in the program and just, you know, true Michigan men. And Joe actually decided to go back for his sixth year. So he's still at the University of Michigan. You know, we always give him a hard time, but he was a guy that used that extra year of eligibility to come back. And I think, you know, he really, 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 you know, feels strong in his decision. I think he's, you know, enjoying being able to return and kind of getting, you know, we're still obviously not sure what the spring's going to look like, but I think there's more hope that, you know, he'll be able to kind of, finish, you know, what we started there. And there's definitely still a core group of guys that were a part of that 2019 team, that are going to try to continue on that, you know, level of play.
I'm so glad you mentioned Joe there. And I wasn't aware that he was going to come back and play. Now, was his decision before or after the surprise graduation ceremony you threw for him and Matt Schmidt, your teammate? So I read about this, Jeff. You apparently got them to come to your place and bribed them with free food. Like, I would go to your place for free food. So yeah, that's an easy yes. But you turned what they thought was going to be a casual hangout into this impromptu graduation ceremony. What can you tell us about it?
Right. So I'll give you a story on the graduation ceremony. That was a good time. So basically it started, I actually don't know how it started. I think, you know, there was like a weekend where all of the seniors at Michigan were going to take their grad photos and kind of do a graduation weekend or whatnot. And Matt and Joe are from, Joe's from California and Matt's from, Colorado. So we weren't really sure what the timing was going to look like. You know, we were in quarantine, but we weren't sure if they were going to be, you know, going home anytime soon or really what anything was going to look like. So we kind of thought, you know, I was talking to my mom, I was talking to a couple of my friends, and we were like, you know, we should throw them a little safe, you know, socially distant, you know, as nice as we can of a little graduation, just to try to, you know, kind of do something for them, right?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Their graduation's canceled, you know, they're not going to get to walk, or at least not anytime soon. And, you know, we thought we'd see what we could do. So I called up my mom, I called up Matt's mom and Joe's mom, and we all kind of collaborated together to see what we could kind of put on for them. So I told them, my mom actually, so this is kind of a different part of the story, but my mom during quarantine, I would drive halfway home. We'd meet at like a rest stop and she would drop off some pre-made meals for me and some food and some nice little gifts and stuff, which is like the best mom ever, but you know, like does the nicest things. And I just told Matt and Joe that my mom had dropped off another, you know, kind of load of food. And I was like, you know, she made way too much. Like I'm not going to be able to eat all this. It wouldn't even last me a month. You know, like you guys got to come help me eat some of this food. And like you said, every, you know, college dude's going to hop on that, you know, offer. So they're like, all right, what time you tell me, we'll be there. So Matt's mom ordered a cake. She got a cake sent and like delivered to the house. Joe Pace's mom ordered some salad, some like breadsticks and stuff. And then my mom made up a big batch of like chicken parmesan that I kind of helped, you know, construct a little bit before the dinner or whatnot. So we got a couple guys, the guys who were at, you know, quarantining with us or whatnot. We got everybody together. We cleared out my living room, like moved the table outside, just completely gutted, like my whole living room. Set up, you know, five or six chairs or whatever it was, a little table. And we got my graduation gown from high school and my roommate, Jordan Wogu, who lives in Ann Arbor, we got his graduation gown from high school. So we had a cap and gown for both Joe and Matt. We ate dinner and then we kind of gave them the surprise. Like, all right, guys, you know, we had our nice dinner. Now we want to put on a little celebration for you. So go upstairs, put the graduation gowns on. We kind of, you know, scurried and set everything up. You know, got a little row made for them. We printed out some fake diplomas. I mean, we really went all the way. We did the whole cards. Turned on the pomp and circumstance, you know, put like everything. Turned on the music. They walked down the stairs, walked in. I like addressed everyone and brought everyone together. And then we had Jimmy Kerr as our keynote speaker, and he spoke some words about their time at Michigan and everything that they had accomplished. And it was actually really, really, really nice. And it was cool for those guys, I think, to, be able to have a little celebration. And even if it wasn't a University of Michigan graduation ceremony, you know, it at least showed them that we cared and, you know, we were proud of them for everything that they'd accomplished here. So, they got to go out in the backyard and pop a bottle of champagne, each of them. And, you know, it was really, really good. So it was a fun time. And like I said, we tried to stay as, you know, safe and to ourselves as we could and, just do a little something for our buddies. So there's a story on that. As far as, you know, back to your original question about Joe, I think he made his decision to come back after. So if I remember correctly, but you know, you never know with Joe. He might have known all along that he was coming back. Just not sure, but yeah.
Well, no, for sure. Good for him. And obviously given the potential shakiness of scheduling and things for this spring. Hope all that turns out well for him and the rest of the guys. You mentioned Jimmy Kerr. That's a former Wolverine. He was drafted by the Tigers last year. He might beat any graduation speaker I've ever had. That's a pretty good get for a thrown together ceremony there, Jeff. That's
right.
That's well done.
Yeah, no, he did a great job, and he said some words about him, and it was really good. I felt bad. I kind of threw him on the spot last minute. We were setting everything up, and they were like, well, who's your keynote speaker? And I was like, well, guys, you know, I've never put on a graduation. I didn't even think about it. And I'm like, Jimmy, like, you probably know the most about Joe and Matt out of everybody. Like, Jimmy, why don't you say a couple words? And he was like, all right, you know, I'll do it, whatever. You know, for being impromptu, he did a phenomenal job. So really, really good stuff out of him for sure.
That's really good stuff out of you. Like, good on you. That's just that's being a great teammate and friend all around. It's very good stuff. We obviously want to talk about your time with Team USA. Let's talk first, and I'm jumping around. Normally I like to do these chronologically, but we're going to jump around to, you know, a bit later in the summer. The draft is coming up. Your world has been rattled by this halted season at Michigan, but you still have hopes of getting taken in the draft. And if not, you know, you've got another year at Michigan that I'm sure you gladly would have taken under different circumstances as well. What were your feelings heading into the draft as you were eventually taken in the second round?
Yeah, you know, going into the draft, it was definitely a weird kind of stressful time with, you know, it obviously being cut down to five rounds. You know, I think at the time before the draft, I was with Jordan, my roommate. We were in quarantine kind of doing the whole thing. And, you know, there were moments of what's this going to look like, really? You know, I think there were so many unknowns, you know, for everyone, not just the players. I think for everyone, there were so many unknowns, that it was just kind of hard to really honestly project what was going to happen. So, you know, either way, the way we looked at it, you know, I wanted to enter professional baseball. You know, I wanted to pursue the draft, and I wanted to take that next step. And, you know, an important thing too is knowing that a lot of these MLB teams, and I think actually everyone, does the college education program. Mm-hmm. So, which is, for those that don't know, just a program so that guys can go back and finish their degrees basically and continue on with their schooling while playing professional baseball. And, you know, with programs like that out there, knowing that I'd be able to return, you know, to finish up my schooling and things of that nature. I felt like with my family and everyone, you know, who kind of went into the decision-making process, we felt like it was best, you know, to just try to pursue professional baseball and see what that, you know, avenue would look like. And it worked out for the best, I think. And, I couldn't be happier with, you know, how things ended up working out. But definitely an unsure time, and definitely kind of some moments of what's this going to look like. But, ultimately it worked out. And, like I said, very, very grateful for the way, the draft panned out for me.
Now, assuming, you were with your family when you found out that you had been drafted, you can tell me, share as much as you want about the maybe a small gathering of sorts or whatever you guys did for this draft. Compare it to the feeling of getting drafted in the 35th round out of high school.
Yeah, it was definitely a lot different. You know, both times with my family, of course. In high school, you know, it's hard thinking back on it. I don't necessarily remember, knowing prior to me being drafted that I was going to be selected. I think it was definitely much more of a surprise, in high school. I had felt pretty confident in going to Michigan. I think that was kind of the decision that, you know, we had made as a family that it was going to be best for my career to go to Michigan to get the education, and really just take all of the opportunities that college baseball has to offer. So, you know, being selected out of high school was definitely a little bit of a surprise for me. While it was late, like you said, in the 35th round, it was definitely an honor, and definitely something that was just a really, really cool moment for me and my family, being that it was the Tigers and kind of my hometown team, the team I'd watched growing up all my life. So both really, really, really cool moments, but, you know, just in there each in different ways. You know, as far as this year with the draft, we did something very similar with Jordan Logu's family. So he lives here in Ann Arbor, and we set up a couple TVs out on their porch and did the same thing, just a real small group of people, you know, kind of socially distant outside. And I got to kind of get the news with him and with my family, as well as, you know, a couple of my coaches were there too. So it was really nice to, you know, kind of have a small group of, you know, kind of my closest people with me, as well as, like I said, my family. My sister was there and her boyfriend, and, you know, everybody who needed to be there. So both really, really cool moments, each kind of unique in their own way, but very grateful for both of those selections.
How cool, from your perspective, was it to be taken by the A's, having, you know, your father there, who had been back in 84, Brian Criswell, a 17th round draft pick to the A's. That's who he represented when he played his professional career a handful of years in their minor league system. I don't know the answer to this. Did you grow up an A's fan because of that?
I did, in a sense. You know, it wasn't like I was a diehard A's fan because of my dad, but I always had that soft spot for him, right?
Yeah.
You know, I think one thing I remember when I was a kid is I always loved the A's unis, and I still do, by the way. But that was, I've always thought that the A's had the coolest uniforms in the league, like by far. So I have been an A's fan, you know, growing up, and the Tigers were kind of my hometown team growing up, and we went to Tigers games, and that's who I had kind of more of an allegiance to. But I definitely was a fan of the A's growing up and liked watching them play. And, you know, the connection with my dad was obviously real there. So, as far as the moment goes, when I was drafted, it was very surreal. It was kind of hard to almost comprehend that it was the same team. So, you know, when everything kind of finally came together for me, I was like, wow, you know, this is really cool to be able to share this experience with my dad. And with my mom, you know, I think it meant a lot to her as well. Just to have that connection there. And obviously, it was a special moment between me and my dad when it happened. And, you know, I got to give him a hug and everything. So, you know, that the connection is really cool and something that I don't think a lot of guys get to experience. And I'm, once again, you know, just really grateful to be able to, you know, have that and share that with him.
Yeah, for sure not something that many get to experience. With that in mind, did you guys talk much about it when you were growing up? I mean, obviously, his love of baseball was translated to you somewhere down the line, and that turned into a love of the game for you. At what point did you, at what point in your life do you even remember finding out that he was a professional baseball player at one point? And I'm sure, being a young ball player at the time yourself, being like, man, that's really cool. How much did you talk about that sort of stuff with him?
Yeah, you know, that's one thing that I can say about my dad is that he just never wanted to talk about that kind of stuff. And it bothered me, man. And he'll listen to this and he'll give me some crap for it, but it's true. He never wanted to talk about himself. He never wanted to talk about his career. He truly is one of the most humble people that I know. And I think that's why I was a little bit hard when I was growing up, because I was like, you know, I knew he played and I'd see the stuff in the basement. And when I kind of finally brought everything together, like, wow, you know, my dad was a good baseball player. Like, he was a professional baseball player. When I kind of brought everything together, I definitely think that, you know, love of baseball grew for me. And, you know, when I got into high school and more serious baseball, You know, those conversations started to evolve and things started to open up a little bit more. And I think as I kind of expressed my love for the game, he, you know, started to share his more and more. Cause I think growing up, ultimately, my dad didn't really want to force anything upon me. Right. And I think that was, you know, kind of his strategy throughout my life was, hey, if he wants to be a basketball player, he can be a basketball player. If he wants to play baseball like I did, he'll play baseball. And, you know, I think there was even a point where my dad said, hey, if you want to be in the musical theater, you can be in the musical theater for all I care. I just want you to be happy. And it worked out in the sense that, you know, I fell in love with baseball and, you know, we got to share that, you know, connection. But he was definitely an integral part of, you know, my love and my desire to play professionally and kind of follow in his footsteps, if you will. So, you know, he was definitely a huge part of that.
You mentioned the musical theater. That's not like an off the wall example. You played like some music I had read in your younger years, right?
Yeah, I did. It was early. It was like when I was young. My sister was a very, very, very accomplished violinist. So I think there was always hope in my family that I was going to kind of gravitate towards an instrument. Like my sister did. I think I was trying everything growing up. I tried the cello and the trombone and the piano. I think at one point the guitar. I mean, I tried everything. And you know, I don't want to say that it was so bad, but it probably was. You know, I clearly didn't grasp anything too well as far as the fine arts went, which, you know, is all good. It wasn't up my alley, but I definitely tried it out. You know, I think my mom was definitely hoping that I would grasp onto an instrument or something of that nature. But I left that to my sister. You know, she really, like I said, was the accomplished violinist of the family. She was in an orchestra that, you know, took us over to China. We got to travel with her and watch her playing some tours in China and things like that. So, I left the music to her and I got to give her credit too. She was an athlete. She swam at Bowling Green and broke 3 school records there.
Yeah,
so,
yep.
I had a lot to live up to. I didn't get to necessarily catch her in the musical side of the the competitive genes in the family. I didn't catch her in music, but you know, we definitely competed as athletes for a long time with each other. So really, really cool, like I said. But I didn't ever really find that instrument that was going to be mine or excel in music by any means, but I definitely gave it a chance. That's for sure.
I've got a feeling a lot of people listening are going to be able to relate to that. Like, I think everybody, if they could, would want to be able to play, like just pick up a guitar and strum, right?
Right. Yeah.
It's not for everybody. It's okay.
Exactly. And that's what I wanted too. I wanted to just be able to pick up a guitar or pick up something, and just be able to play. But, you know, however many hours I spent clearly wasn't enough because I never, but that's all right.
Man, there is a lot of new stuff over at usabaseballshop.com. Have you checked it out yet? Maybe you're rounding out your holiday shopping or perhaps just getting started. I promise you, you'll benefit from a visit to usabaseballshop.com. There's truly something for everyone, including some of the holiday season's best sellers, like the vast beanie collection that includes about a dozen different styles of knit caps from New Era. If you like the big palm on top, if you like stripes or maybe the tacky sweater pattern, or something more subdued like a solid navy with the US Star logo featured, you'll find at least one to keep warm this winter. So go check out the New Era Beanie Collection as well as all the new arrivals and holiday deals at usabaseballshop.com.
You mentioned traveling to China. That's a good chance to segue into your time with Team USA because of the travel there that was associated with you being on the collegiate national team. You guys went to Taiwan and Japan. What was it like to find out you were going to be able to represent your country? I mean, that was your first experience with a USA baseball team on the collegiate national team in 2019. What do you remember about the moment finding out that you were invited to training camp?
Yeah, so it was a very big surprise for me. Basically the way things worked out was we had finished up with the College World Series, and I wasn't really sure where I was going to be playing, if I was going to continue to play, really what the rest of my summer was going to look like. Then I got a call from Eric, who, you know, invited me to come play. And it was just an incredibly surprising moment. That was kind of something that I had dreamed of for so long, something that I had wanted to accomplish for so long, you know, to be able to represent my country. And when I finally got that opportunity, it was like, wow, you know, this is really happening. And, you know, the next day or within the next 2 days, I was on a plane going down to North Carolina. So it was a quick turnaround, and it was, you know, I was flown right down there and kind of thrown right in the mix, but I couldn't have been happier about it. And I was incredibly, you know, just grateful to be able to get the opportunity to continue playing that summer. And, you know, I couldn't have, you know, had a better experience, like you said, traveling overseas and being able to be a part of that collegiate national team.
Safe to say this was the best collection of talent you've ever played with at the same, like on one team?
I do think so. Yeah. I mean, it's pretty hard to argue there. I think if you watch the 2020 draft, you know, all the big dogs up top, I think it was pretty easy to see with Torque and Marty and, all those guys, you know, just really, you know, kind of setting the example for how things were going to, you know, be played, and they were great leaders on the team. And from the top down, you know, it was just a really, really good group of guys, all who had, you know, an incredible level of talent. So it was really cool to be able to be surrounded by those guys and, to play alongside them for a couple games, you know?
Yeah. What were your expectations coming in? And that, I can mean that in a variety of ways, right? Like, for yourself and performance wise, you did pretty well, 3 appearances, struck out 4, got the 1 save. You know, again, on a staff that's as big and as loaded as that, in sort of the limited schedule, you're only going to get so many opportunities. Did you have anything in mind that you really wanted to do or accomplish on the field?
You know, I can say I didn't have a ton of expectations going in. I think I was pretty just kind of open and grateful to be a part of the team. You know, I really wasn't sure what I was going to look like after throwing, you know, 100 something innings during college ball. You know, I didn't know what it was going to look like starting or leaving or anything like that. So I didn't have a ton of expectations going in. I kind of just went in open-minded, knowing that, you know, whatever opportunity I was going to get, I was just going to take and, you know, try to keep my head down and do the best I can to, help the team win. So that was kind of the approach I wanted to take, was whatever role, whatever opportunity, whatever, you know, chance you're given, you know, just do the best you can to represent the United States of America and give your team a chance to win. So that was, I think, kind of my main goal going in, and my main focus was just, like I said, to do anything that I could and, help the team out in any way, you know, whatever that was going to look like.
You mentioned Austin Martin from Vanderbilt. Tyler Brown was also on that collegiate national team. Now, you guys had just finished playing against them in the College World Series. Was there a moment, maybe just like a witty exchange with one of those two or both at the time that you guys arrived in North Carolina?
You know, they were really good sports about it. They were very, very humble, and very, you know, they were really good about it. Like, you know, I went in, I'd known Brownie before. I'd played some summer ball with him my senior year of high school for the Midland Redskins. And I didn't know Austin personally, but, we actually became pretty fast friends. You know, like I said, I knew Tyler before, and, you know, I think he might have given me a hard time a little bit here and there. I'm not sure if I remember, but like I said, I remember those guys being very humble about, you know, winning and very respectful, you know, towards everybody about, you know, just coming off a national championship, because that's a really big deal. And they could have easily taken it a different way. So that's one thing I can say about those guys. I was very impressed. You know, with the way they carry themselves after winning a national championship, and you could see their mindset, you know, flip just as quickly as anybody else's to, hey, let's go play for USA and let's go win. So, you know, really good. It was all good there. You know, there was no, nothing that I guess is really too, interesting, but they were good sports about it.
Yeah. Good guys.
Yeah. Really, really good guys.
Who else did you find yourself palling around with the most?
Yeah, so I had some I had some friends like prior to going in, Casey Opitz and Luke Waddell were also a part of that Midland Redskins team in high school. Mm-hmm. So I had been really, really good friends with Luke, Casey, and Tyler going in. And then I had also played with Reed Detmers the previous summer in Brewster. So I had known some guys going in. I had some familiar faces, which was nice. And then, you know, Pat Bailey and Max Meyer were, you know, kind of fast friends of mine as well. Max being a Big Ten guy, we just kind of had that instant connection. I think at one point we had a conversation with some of the guys on the team. We were the only two who knew how to ice skate on the team or something like that. Like, I think everybody was like mind blown that we'd grown up playing pond hockey and doing stuff up here in the north. And they were like, wait. You guys know how to play hockey. You know, Max played hockey in high school, I think. And, I'm no, you know, hockey player, but I played a little bit, you know, with my buddies growing up. So, you know, we had kind of that instant connection between the two of us where we became good friends. And, Pat just being another catcher that, you know, pitchers and catchers are always around each other. We became, good friends too. So it was all together a really solid group of guys. You know, I think to some extent I was good friends with most guys on the team. We all kind of came together, I think, pretty well collectively, and you know, got along well. So it was a really, really cool group of guys to be a part of.
Now, I mentioned the travel aspect, Taiwan, Japan. What was that like? You had said you had done some international travel before to go see your sister perform, but had you ever done it in that capacity where it was sort of, you know, it was you leading the way, whereas it was your sister leading the way with the trips to China. This was with a team, right? I mean, and that's, I mean, those are long flights, Jeff.
Right.
What do you remember most about the trips to and during the time spent in those places?
Yeah. So like you mentioned, it was my first time, you know, in Asia with a team. We had gotten the opportunity my freshman year at Michigan to go down to the Dominican as a team, and play against some teams down there and do an international trip at Michigan. So I had traveled outside of the country with the team before, but, you know, Japan and Taiwan and the, you know, 16, when you talk about 16, 17 hour flights and a couple hour bus rides, it was a lot different. And, you know, I wouldn't say it was different in a bad sense. It was just a lot longer. Like you said, you know, you're up in there for 16, 17, you know, those are long flights to be a part of, but, you know, everybody just kind of hangs back, puts the headphones on, sleeps, and, you know, we wake up eventually and we're there. So, you know, the travel was definitely different. It was longer. You know, it was a little bit hard, but it was nothing that, you know, I don't think anybody could handle. And I think, you know, coming back was definitely a little bit harder, just with kind of the jet lag and stuff. When we got over there, it was like game mode, you know, kind of get ready, go play, go get out there and get after it. And I remember when I came home, you know, it was a long flight and we flew from Japan to LA to Michigan. You know, that was definitely a lot longer of a journey home, but, you know, all part of the experience and all part of, you know, just getting to go play over there. So I wouldn't have traded, you know, the travel for anything. It was a part of it. And I think it's kind of what makes the travel aspect unique and what makes it fun in a sense.
Yeah. And you get a heavy dose of this now as a professional, but given those trips, and you can lump the Dominican trip with your team at Michigan into this if you want, what were your impressions of international baseball? Because I think it's safe to say up in Michigan, you didn't play with too many guys of, you know, Japanese descent growing up, or guys from the Dominican growing up, or anything like that. Whereas, you know, it's the same game, but as you've learned, it's different in different places of the world. What were your impressions of just the internationality of the game of baseball?
It is different. You know, it's like you said, it's still baseball, but it is different, man. I think one of the biggest wake up calls, or kind of one of the biggest differences that I saw, especially over in like Japan, was the pregame routines. And the way they warmed up and kind of the communication and the language piece of things. You know, I thought they communicated really, really well over there. They played really, really, really fundamental baseball. And I think that was really cool to see, kind of baseball almost at its purest form, with bunting, hit and run, you know, just an incredibly focused and detail oriented style of play, which was really, really cool to see. As well as just kind of the different styles of guys' games, you know, the way they carry themselves. I think all of it just is really, really cool to see. And I think it makes you realize too that we're all just baseball players. You know, we had a really, really cool moment at the end of the Japan series where we kind of came together and took some team photos with the two teams. And, while the language barrier was there, we were still able to communicate with some of the guys. We were able to trade some gear, you know, trade a pair of cleats or a wristband or a hat or something here and there. And ultimately realize that we're all just kind of baseball players, you know, and we're all young kids who love the game of baseball and are out there just having fun. So it's really cool, like I said, to kind of see the different styles of play and to see, you know, the different way that each kind of culture, I guess, plays the game of baseball. But it's also cool in the same sense to be able to come together as baseball players and have that connection. So really, really cool.
Well, let's wrap up by talking about the here and now, or the most recent. You were able to play in the instructional league this summer, so you were able to get some professional baseball under your belt before this next season. How did you feel about playing at the pro level for the first time, and how do you think you've progressed?
Yeah, I think it was really, really, really fun. You know, I think that was kind of the biggest thing. It was fun to get back out there. It was fun to get out on the field, to, you know, get back in a clubhouse, get back with some guys, meet some new faces, and see some old faces, and really just kind of get back into what baseball is, you know, being able to get that coaching and that instruction, and really the level of care from the staff that I think a lot of minor league guys have been missing for a long time. You know, obviously with the season being canceled, there was a lot of guys on their own for a long time. So I think being able to come back together and get a little sense of normalness was really, really cool. And it was a lot of fun to meet new guys, you know, meet the guys that you're going to hopefully advance through the organization with, and meet the coaches and meet the staff and the guys who are going to be there to help you along the way. So I couldn't have been more grateful to get the opportunity to do the instructional league. You know, I was fortunate that the A's, decided to put one on, because I know, you know, not every team did. So I think, you know, as a collective group, when we were there, we were all just really happy that we were given the opportunity to be able to go play, as well as, you know, get better and use this time and use this instructional league to try to, you know, improve our game and really hone in on some of the things that we needed to get better at. So, all in all, instructional league was incredible, and I was really glad to be able to be a part of it.
Did anything about playing baseball for a professional organization maybe take you by surprise at first, whether it has to do with the level of play or the speed of play or something totally off the field?
Yeah, I mean, I think introducing, you know, like we had talked about a little bit before with some of the new Latin players and kind of seeing and being able to play with guys from different cultures, I think that was one of the biggest differences in professional baseball, and something that I really, really enjoyed. Kind of being able to chat with guys, kind of my broken Spanish and their broken English, you know, to be able to share dialect with guys from different countries and continue to evolve, you know, with those kind of players, that was a really, really cool opportunity. And, you know, kind of a different aspect of professional baseball than you would see in college, you know, as well as just kind of the level of accountability that you have to have for yourself. Ultimately, you know, when you're in college, you're a part of a team, and not that you're not in professional baseball, but you're definitely held a little bit more accountable for your actions. And what you do on a daily basis is, you know, might be different than what the next guy does. And I think that's a little bit different, you know, in a sense than college baseball and maybe some, you know, other levels that you played on before. So all in all, you know, it is a little bit of a difference, but something that I think is really, really cool, and something that's fun to be a part of, and definitely something I'm looking forward to getting back into in the spring.
How did you feel about the level of competition? Was it a pretty easy transition from playing at Michigan to what you were seeing at the instructional league?
Yeah, I mean, guys are definitely better. you know, I'll be honest about it. You know, when you get into professional baseball, you're seeing everybody's Friday night guy, or you're seeing everybody's three-hole hitter. And I think that sometimes you know, goes a little bit overlooked. You know, that's your lineup is consistent of what you're going to see in the bulk of a college order. And there's not many holes up and down, you know, a professional lineup. You know, that each guy you got to worry about, and each guy has his own strengths and weaknesses. Not to say that that's not the case in college, because it is, but, guys are definitely better. You know, guys definitely hit mistakes better. You know, you don't get as what, to put it this way, you don't get away with as much in professional baseball as, you know, you might in college. And that just comes, you know, with the skill of the hitters, guys, you know, strike zones become a little bit smaller. You know, hitters have better takes, and, the game just gets better. Everything picks up, you know, a little bit. The game gets a little bit faster each time, you know, I think you advance. And, that was definitely a little bit prevalent in the instructional league. You know, everybody's good, like I said. So that's what you got to remember. Everyone's there for a reason. So,
last thing, what have you been told by the A's about what to expect in terms of your development? Are you being treated as more of a starting pitcher, or a somebody that's going to come out of the bullpen, or is the jury still out on that?
You know, as far as I know, I can't speak for, you know, what they're thinking, but to my knowledge, you know, up to this point, I think I'm still, you know, in a starting position.
Yeah.
During instructional league, I was, I believe, you know, treated as a starter, and I got a couple starts out there. So, you know, I'm hoping and thinking going forward that I'll continue in a starting role. But, you know, there hasn't been a ton of direct communication, you know, outright about what things are going to look like going forward. But like I said, I think, you know, at this point, I'm still in a starting position role. Continuing to start some games, and I think it'll continue that way into spring training. But like I said, you know, I don't want to speak for them or any decision that they're going to make.
Sure thing. And I know you'd be just as fine being in the bullpen too, if it came down to that. So, because obviously with the Collegiate National Team, we saw you do it well. We saw you do it well at Michigan when called upon. You're just a pitcher, man. That's what I think teams liked about you.
I try. It's always been one thing. It's just, you know, whenever the ball, is being handed to you for me, I'll always take it, whatever that role is, whatever the inning or situation is, you know, if the opportunity is presented to me to pitch, I'm going to go pitch. So
good stuff, man. Well, Jeff, again, appreciate the time. Best of luck going into your off season. Best to you and yours with the holidays coming up. But proud to have you as a USA Baseball alum, and can't thank you enough for the time.
No doubt, Daron. Thank you so much for having me on. I had a great time today chatting, and I really appreciate it. So I hope you have a safe and healthy and happy holidays as well. And, you know, I hope to catch up soon.
I'm joined by Ben Meyer, a former collegiate pitcher at Claremont McKenna College in California and current mobile software engineer at Diamond Kinetics. Thanks for joining me, Ben. Can you start off by telling me what it is that Diamond Kinetics does?
Hey, thanks for having me on covering the bases today, Daron. Over at Diamond Kinetics, we make baseball hardware and sensors that help you gather live data while training. And so we make sensors that go into the bats and into the balls that get you all sorts of metrics while you're looking out. And so, for instance, the pitch tracker ball lets you get your spin rate, velocity, and some break metrics. While you're training with Diamond Kinetics equipment, you can get all sorts of live feedback on how your pitches are performing.
And as a former collegiate pitcher, I'm sure you're pretty familiar with the pitch tracker ball. I'm interested in learning more about your experience. When did you start using technology to help your growth as a pitcher?
Yeah, so I was a pitcher at Claremont McKenna College and was always interested in data-driven training. And so I was overtraining at the Texas Baseball Ranch and working on some off-speed pitches, where I started learning the importance of measuring things like spin rate and spin axis. You know, these are great ways to objectively measure the movement of a pitch. And there they introduced me to the Diamond Kinetics Pitch Tracker, which was great for getting live feedback and tracking progress. And so within a year, with a lot of hard work, the platform helped me get my curveball spin rate, for instance, from around 2,000 to around 2,900.
And now that you're working with Diamond Kinetics, I would imagine this was like the perfect marriage. So while you were pitching at Claremont McKenna, what were you studying, and how did you find yourself at Diamond Kinetics?
So I entered college very interested in sabermetrics. I was studying math and computer science, and knew that eventually I would find myself somewhere in sabermetrics or baseball data. And so as I was studying, a lot of my classes were in data analysis and machine learning. And when it came time to apply for a job afterwards, Diamond Kinetics was just a perfect fit. And fortunately, they agreed.
That is perfect. Well, tell me a bit more about what you do as a mobile application engineer at Diamond Kinetics. I understand you've made some pretty significant additions to the Pitch Tracker product recently, right? How were you able to apply your background to the Pitch Tracker product?
Yeah, so as someone who used Pitch Tracker, something I always found value in was labeling my pitch types as I threw. So while I'm going through a session, I'm labeling my curveballs, my sliders, my fastballs. And so this way, when viewing session summaries after looking back through the app, I can see all my metrics sorted out per pitch type. And the only downside to this really is that now you either have to bring someone with you to label your data, or you are pausing between pitches in, say, your bullpen to take the time to do this. And this can get a bit tedious, especially if you're throwing a long bullpen. And so in my free time while working at Diamond Kinetics, I started experimenting with using machine learning in the app to automatically label the pitches. And we saw some success with this and have added this as a feature in Pitch Tracker. So now as our users throw, the app can automatically determine their pitch types for them as well.
That seems really helpful. And keeping in mind that you're speaking to a novice, I've always wondered just how you can teach a computer anything in that way. How do you get it to determine what the pitch type is? And can you give, just the brief basics?
Yeah, so as a bit of an overview of how this works, we use a neural network and a clustering algorithm. And so these take a number of features such as from the pitch, such as its velocity, spin rate, and axis as input, and they use some math and try to determine what the pitch type was. And so initially, our users just need to label a few pitches for us, and then the algorithms can take over from there. And they continue to fine-tune themselves as the user continues to throw. What makes this kind of interesting, too, is that the algorithms are needed to be effective for users of all levels, from Little League to professional, because we have users of all levels using our apps. If we were doing this with just professional players, it'd be a little bit of an easier task. You know, any pitch in the 90s is clearly a fastball, or a pitch in the 70s is going to be some sort of curveball or off-speed. But when dealing with users from all different levels, we see a huge range in, say, fastball velocities from 40 to around 100 or so. And so what our models need to do is learn the relationships between features like velocity and spin that learn the pitch types, rather than just memorize common values. And so a cool advantage we have here also is that since our sensors are embedded inside the ball, not only are we getting all these metrics, but we can also actually see how they're holding the ball. So for developing users that are on our platform, if you're still trying to learn how to throw a pitch and you're not quite getting the movement you want yet, we can actually use your grip factored into the algorithm. And that can help us to make our predictions as well.
So you said Pitch Tracker is now in the App Store with this new ability to predict pitch types. What are we going to be able to do in the app now that it's classifying pitches for us?
Yes, there's two main ways that this is really going to help the users out. First off, it's just the convenience. So, you know, you can go out and throw. You don't have to worry about collecting your data. Since launch, we've found that we're about 95% accurate in our predictions. So you can just go throw and be confident that we're getting the labels for you. And then the other benefit that kind of comes from this is improved session summaries. As you throw, you know, your pitches get separated out by pitch type. And this helps you view your metrics afterwards, such as velocity and spin rate, averaged and separated out by each pitch. It's much more valuable than when you see them all just aggregated together. And so previously, only about 5% of our users were actually taking the time to label their pitches, but now we're able to provide these types of summaries for all users because we have the machine learning models doing the work. And it doesn't require any extra work from the user, which is great.
And where can those listening get access to all this great data?
They can get access to this by using the Diamond Kinetics Pitch Tracker. And we're actually having a great sale on our website right now for the holidays. So you should go ahead and check it out.
Thanks again. That's Ben Meyer with Diamond Kinetics. Ben, thanks so much for talking to me today.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Daron.
That'll do it for episode 35 of Covering the Bases. Again, my thanks to Jeff Criswell for joining me. It was great to catch up with him, talk about this past year or so, just such a bizarre beginning to his professional baseball career, so I appreciate his candor. And if you need to catch up on Covering the Bases episodes, definitely go back. Listen to Mark DeRosa, who was our most recent guest. We had Michael Young on recently as well. Some really good ones in our past handful of episodes for sure. And I'll go ahead and give you a heads up. You do not want to miss our next and final episode of the year 2020. I won't give it away just yet, but know that a member of the National Baseball Hall of Fame will be my guest. Subscribe wherever you get your podcasts, rate and review wherever you get your podcasts, tell your friends, suggest this to someone who you think might also enjoy these conversations with baseball stars and future stars and former stars. But thanks for joining us, and until next time, I'll catch you later.